You are listening to SoFloRadio.com.
Wait a minute. Have you heard the George Rodriguez Show? Then you don't know Balaam from your ass. George Rodriguez.
Oh, he's a nondescript little Cuban.
That's a good-looking guy.
What word did you say?
Look what that kid's doing to my radio station. High ratings and women. He's creating way too much work for me to do. George, you're fired. Now, where's my LSD?
It ends like that. No, I was gonna play. What is it? Did I say Grimes? Because that's the latest musical discovery. For me, I gotta qualify that. I know Grimes. For the really cool people in the audience, oh Grimes. Grimes is like so last year. Was new to me last year, so I was gonna do that, but then I forgot. We got a theme going today because we're gonna be promoting the 18th annual medical marijuana benefit concert at Gramps in Wynwood.
Yay.
With Flash. Flash is coming in here today. Flash is a regular on the show when he's got a concert that he's promoting. And no matter what concert he's promoting, I call it the medicinal marijuana concert, because that's just where my head gets all wrapped up around Flash. He was here the last time, and he was doing I think it was a benefit for the Everglades or something. I don't know, because I got this mental block.
I remember that on Facebook.
I associate Flash with the medicinal marijuana concert. So he's going to be coming in here around 2 o'clock, and the reason we started at 1 today is because that's as early as my producer could make it, and I gotta make do with what I have these days, and it's sunset. Welcome to the George Show.
Yes, I'm so excited.
I know. Thank you. It is exciting. We have a lot of fun here. You have a lot of fun. Emily Sunset, I'm borrowing from Z Nation. She's Zayna's producer, but yes. I'm allowed to borrow her because I taught her how to do the work
everything.
And the levers and everything, and you're very qualified, and you guys are kicking ass.
Yeah.
And doing all kinds of things, but you're doing yoga class, you're teaching a teacher class, and this is as early as you can make it, and I'm happy to take it. And that, by the way, that fits in with the whole new schedule, the whole George turned 50 and ran out of fucks. This is a recurring theme on my show. I don't know if it was an epiphany, you know, enlightenment. You guys talk about enlightenment and stuff like that, and
yes,
having epiphanies
do.
And everything. And how do you know if what the other person is experiencing is what you're experiencing? You really don't. You can only you only know your own experience. So I don't
yes.
know if what I had was an epiphany, you know, an enlightenment, a moment of enlightenment, or a nervous breakdown. I don't know. I don't know what it was. I just know that I woke up one day and I couldn't find a fuck to save my life. I mean, I looked all around for the fucks and they were gone.
They were all
yeah. So I went to the beach. That's how it all started. I rode my bike to the beach because because that was the next stage. It's like, wow, I can't find a fuck to save my life. So what would you like to do with your fuckless life today, George? And
if
I could do anything right now, I'd be at the beach smoking a cigar.
Yeah.
Drinking, a cocktail.
Mm-hmm.
And so I pre-mixed a Jug-O cocktail. Okay. I took the vodka and the juice out of my fridge and I pre-mixed. Pre-mixed. Sorry. Well, sometimes it's tequila. I make margaritas.
I like tequila.
The first one was pre-mixed margaritas.
Ooh.
Okay. So, and then I stopped at Publix for a big old sub. I already had the big fat cigar, and that's what I did. I sat there on the beach in my little recliner thingy, and I thought, this is good. I could get used to this. Because this is what rich people do, right? So, anyway, but I digress. So, I've been starting the show whenever the fuck I feel like it, or ending, because sometimes I end at 2 o'clock so I can go skating. Which I've been doing a lot. As a matter of fact, the people that know me, my friends, I know you love me. Thank you. Skating's all I talk about anymore because that's pretty much all I'm doing. I'm going to people's parties. If somebody's having
nice.
A birthday party or something and they invite me, I'll go. I'm going to try to make that thing. That thing that you guys are cooking up, the fundraiser. I saw the
poster. Oh, yes. The 1 year.
Talk about
we
that.
Did 1 year.
1 year here on
SoFlo. Nation at SoFlo, and we're trying to have a big old party in March, March 19th. The location is to be announced, but we have a location.
Still looking for one?
Yeah, we're still looking for a location. We're going to go check out one place. It's like a ranch. So it's nice, we can do whatever the fuck we want, basically. Like, no fucks, whatever.
No fucks given.
Yeah, and we just want people to come out, vibe out. We're going to have some open mic, so if you want to come...
But you're
going to
do it on a Saturday.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can do my best like this thing. Like and it breaks my heart that I won't be able to go yet again to the benefit concert. You know, I love... I love everything that's going on here. I love all the bands that he's going to have on. I like this kind of a scene, but they do it on a Saturday, and I've pretty much committed to going skating all the time. As a matter of fact, it's not even like I don't know anybody that I can use for a stand-in. Babysitting is one thing, but somebody to take her skating is another thing. The older daughter, which used to be very handy,
Had a baby.
So
beautiful,
yeah.
Beautiful baby.
This is my first show since I became a grandfather.
Oh my God. Like 2 weeks
how does ago.
That feel like?
It's kind of squishy. Feels kind of squishy. Kind of, you know, there's a little bit of softness, a little tenderness. No, it feels, that's, that fits right into the whole I can act a fool, all out of fucks. I already got a grandkid. You understand by nature's standard, by the law of evolution and survival of the fittest, I'm absolutely extra credit on the planet right now. I'm completely superfluous. You know what other mammal? What other mammal? There's only one other mammal where the grandparents play a role. I just found this out. Where the grandparents play a role in the life of the grandchild.
What?
Only one. The elephant.
What?
Yeah. All of the grandparents are like, by the time that, you know, the kids come around, the grandparents are gone from the scene or just completely disinterested and don't really. I really thought like maybe the chimps or the gorillas would have something. It's like, nah. That's what this article said. I mean, who knows? I mean, you know, I read it on Facebook, so you know it's going to be. It has to be true. Right? And everything on Facebook is absolutely true. Meanwhile, back to my commitments, we came to a point, we came to a turning point with the whole roller skating thing where my daughter, who's going to be 14 soon, really just wants to skate or be left alone.
Mm.
And meaning, she'll play Wii, she'll do the things that are required of her, like go to school, do her homework and everything. She'll play Wii, she'll make videos on GoAnimate on her computer, but basically it means interacting.
Producer in the making.
And yeah, and it's Wii music that she's playing. So she's doing creative things, but they're interacting with electronics thing, which a lot of children on the spectrum, that's their thing. The good news is, she's not really, I really need to turn this thing off. She's not really watching TV. She doesn't do watching TV. It's all creative things. Nevertheless, it's in front of an electronics thing. It's either she doesn't want, and she doesn't. She doesn't like outside. It's heartbreaking. Come on in, Flash. Flash is here. Sit down.
Hello, Flash.
You can sit there and get comfy for my rant. I have some Whitman's chocolates and almond milk. If you would like. Do we have another person today, or is it just? It's all right. It's just us. Get comfy. You know the routine. It totally eco-hostile water in the fridge. I didn't put it there. I didn't have time to stop at the well. Oh, look at that. Flash brought his own. But meanwhile, back to stories. So she said she wanted to go Saturday and Sunday. This happened a few months ago. Normally we would go Wednesday and Sundays. And then she said, and I find it very difficult to argue with these points that she's making. Dad, can we go skating today also, meaning Saturday and Sunday? The alternative being she's going to be on the computer making videos. She won't go out, like, let's go skating outside, honey. Don't think I didn't go through this. Let's, 'cause she's got rollerblades. Let's go skating outside. How about a bike? She wouldn't ride the bike. No, don't want to be outside. Doesn't like the wind whipping her hair in her face. Doesn't like the wind whipping her hair back and forth in her face.
It's probably because it just feels sensitive.
She doesn't like it. Like, doesn't like it. She'll do PE. She'll do it if she has to. But if she doesn't have to, it's a freak
she's
out.
She's like, it's my time. This is what I want to do. And I will put my foot down.
And my response as a parent was like, well, why not? Why not? There's absolutely nothing physically stopping us. Go crazy. We already ate a whole layer.
Please take them away. Like,
man.
Out of my fill.
I like your t-shirt there, Flash. We'll get into the thing. We got some politics to discuss today, but I have to check some personal things off the list over here. Look, I wrote all these things down. I'll get rid of the minutia and build up to the Flash thing. His beard is getting longer.
Oh my god.
Flash is the coolest looking guy. You know that's his real name too.
Flash?
Jealous. This is the jealous guy right here. Because I have a name that's boring in two languages.
And make up your name. I made up my name.
I know. It's too late. Everybody knows me as George Rodriguez. It's too late. But I'm working on merging myself into the Ivan Bad persona. Ivan Bad.
That's your new name?
That's my new name. That's my middle name. Yeah. Flash did a show with Ivan Bad. We'll do it again. We had a smoke-in. It was a lot of fun from what I can remember. from watching it, right. Ivan Bad is my secret. George Rodriguez is the secret identity of Ivan Bad. Ivan Bad is the character.
All right. Yeah. I like that. That sounds nice.
Ivan has a middle name.
Ivan Bad.
Barry. His middle name is Barry
Bad.
Yeah. Get it?
Oh my God.
There's comedy involved in that name.
Yes.
And it's my own. I own ivanbad.com. Yeah, so this is what I want to do one of these days. I want to just murder George. Have Ivan Bad come in here and murder George Rodriguez. Because George is just... it starts with having a boring name. Then it's a spick name. You see how doomed I am? See, here's the problem with a spick name. People scrolling through radio show directories and everything, they see George Rodriguez. And if they're a gringo, they're going to think that's a spick name. So that's a spick show. And they're just going to keep on scrolling. I don't peeky pani. So they're just going to keep on scrolling. A Julio is going to see that name, tune in, hear this gringo talking and go, okay, say so. And yeah. So it's a bad idea. It's doomed. And I didn't even think it through. I walked into a radio station and I immediately started using my real name. What an idiot.
But you
like, I don't
what?
Know better. You just make it up. Make up a rapper name right then and there. Fatty Meats. What's your name? Fatty? Fatty Meats. Pleased to meet you with a PH.
Of course. Well, I mean, you still made it, right? Like, look how long you've been doing
this. I could have made it more. And by made it, I mean I could have hit that ratio where you work a few hours for much money. Right now, I'm working few hours for a little bit of money. But it affords me the ability to go to the beach and go skating. Meanwhile, back to skating, because I'm doing this big long thing about why Saturdays are so impossible for me. So I said, yeah, honey, we can. And now once that becomes a rule or a principle with my autism spectrum daughter, once you establish a precedent, it's very difficult without a meltdown, a freak out, or just a bummer time. It's very difficult to make a change to the established rule. And I told her, yeah, I'll take you skating every Saturday. And it was a very happy moment. Woohoo. And we started going, now we're going Wednesday, Saturday, and Sunday. And then she said, because she reads the schedule on the wall at the roller rink too, then she says, and she noticed it, because I made arrangements one day to take her on a no school day. There was no school on, you know, teacher work day, whatever it was. And the rink is always open because of all the little neglectorinos, all the little orphans that do day camp. You know, they got the single parents, and so they do daycare camp. You're aware of these things, right?
Peripherally.
But the people who work, you understand, the people who work, they have these things that they're like kennels, but for children.
They
still have concrete floors and they still hose the feces into the drain there, but the cages are better appointed. They're more padded, walls. What's that?
No hay?
No hay. Although sawdust floor, hay on the floor. I don't know why they haven't thought of that yet. Because there's some are better than others because they all go to the roller rinks. You see the buses there. And some of the buses are super high tech. You can see them. They're all nice and shiny.
I know. They got AC, you know, and all that. AC, they didn't have that when I was in school.
And then they have the horse-drawn carriage bus, you know, from the Amish camp.
Amish camp?
No, I'm making that shit up right now. I just pulled that right out of my crazy head.
Wow.
But there, you can see some of the buses are old and rusty, and so there's different levels of camper there, mm-hmm. and starved for attention kids. And anyway, and like a handful of parents that do have the day off, and that's what they chose to do with their child on their day off, is take them to the roller rink. Well, she put it together that when there's no school, the rink is open. And so the next question was, Dad, why aren't we skating on these days when there's no school and the rink is open? And now she doesn't even know that she's threatening me with the alternative. She doesn't know that that's, because that's what I'm hearing. She doesn't say the words, because otherwise, you know, I'm just going to be playing on the Wii all day. She doesn't say that, but I know that that's, because what else? She's not going to go outside. She's not going to do anything like that. She's not going to go to the beach. So there's that. So now we're taking her. And so now we're up to like four, minimum three, sometimes five or six. If it's spring break or something like that, it's like every day that I can possibly take off. But now the Saturday thing has become like a cardinal thing. So here's what I'm going to try to do in both of these cases. Take her skating during the day and see if I can get a sitter for the evening so I can fulfill all of my commitments, because I have yet, and I feel like a big fat hypocrite, I have yet to go to one of these things, even though I think this is the fourth time that I've had Flash on to promote this particular event. I explained to Sunset before you came in that no matter what event you're promoting, I call it the whatever annual medicinal marijuana concert. I'm really frozen in there. The last one was for the Everglades. Oh, see, like I was right.
I remember.
I got it right finally. Yeah, I must have said that like 20 times before you came in here. That's when you should absolutely text me. And
I'm on bicycle, I came through.
Did you ride your bike today?
Yeah.
Oh wow, through the storm.
It was dry for me. It was cold, but it was dry.
This is the temperature that I like to ride my bike.
I took the tri-rail. I took the Metro Rail to the tri-rail, and then I rode from the tri-rail to here.
Excellent. Flash, in case you don't know, you know, he walks the walk, and by that I mean he rides a bike.
Nice.
He doesn't. He doesn't have a car, and that's admirable. I always mention that when he comes in. That's very admirable. And
that's cool, because it's like not safe here to ride a bike a lot of the time.
Yeah,
you do have to be a little bit crazy.
Defensive,
I think, in some way. Yeah. Defensive is more just, I wouldn't call it defensive riding as much as aware riding.
Yeah,
and they're aware. Sort of like, here I am, deal with me, and also make sure you have good brakes. Mm-hmm. So there are different factors within this, but
I ride my bike. I mean, I don't ride it as much as you do. I ride it to the beach because I can. And I just got, just so you know, I got a little phone holder because I have to have my phone in front of me while I'm riding my bike because I'm got people calling me all the time. I have to run this business. So that's my latest thing. And phone holder, cup holder, basket in the back for the cooler.
I want to get those two big, what is
like
it?
Like the saddlebags or the rear view mirrors?
Yeah, I want to get the mirrors.
Yeah? You got a bike? So I think your bike could be a little bit louder. That's just me.
No.
Yes.
My bike is one of those fold bikes because I live in a condo, so I can't like have my big bike out.
So you have a folding bike?
Yeah.
You can put in people's cars?
Yeah, I could put in people's
cars. That's cool.
Cars,
that's too. Handy.
Yeah, it's nice.
We should schedule a bike day. Do you ever have a weekday off?
Yeah,
let's do bike day to the beach. I know some other people. Flash lives too far away, so
I can't. I don't really do the beach during the day, personally.
You know?
You like it at night?
Yes.
I like, go to the beach
like
a lot
both,
at night,
but
too.
The big ball of fire is just hot.
It's very hot, yeah. You have to slather on the cocoa butter. You don't like that?
It's not really my stuff.
Don't want to get cancer?
No. I'm just usually riding, so... Yesterday I rode for like 7 hours just flying all around.
Excellent.
Wow. So I just decided to go north and I just kept going.
Great way to stay fit. How far, because you live close to downtown or in downtown?
No, I actually live in South Miami, but I started at around 7 o'clock after I left 7th Circuit, and then I went east to Biscayne, and then I hit north in Biscayne, and then I went all the way up to 163rd. Then I went west, and then I went all the way down south to South Miami. So that was about 7 hours of riding and about 1,000.
What kind of bike do you have? Like speed bike? Like
no, I have a Signal. I have a hybrid.
Okay.
And moved the handlebars from the long mountain bike ones to the curved ones just because I realized that if I'm going to ride, I need something more narrow because there are certain times that having those extra couple inches out there, you'll clip something.
Yeah.
And I've gone through very narrow things between traffic and road stuff that
no,
your inches were,
you're right,
yeah,
you're absolutely right. When I go to the beach, I put umbrellas and shit back there, so you should say I look like a homeless person when I go to the beach. I look, well, because I want to be comfortable when I go there.
Yeah, you know, Murphy's Law thing.
Yes indeed. But enough about that. Flash is here to promote, and actually you're
I'm here a little early, actually.
You are here a little early, and I don't know why my nose is itching right now for absolutely no reason. I'm having an allergic reaction, so that's going to look really good on the video. I told Sunset, don't turn the camera on yet, we might want to pick our nose. Looks like I should have picked mine a little bit more than that. Flash is early, but that's to be expected because you don't know what time the train.
I didn't want to be late, and I wasn't sure exactly where the studio was as far as the number. So I'm like, I got here. I'm looking around, going, "Oh, it's here!" And then I walk in, and here we are, current events.
Yeah.
So I was actually going to go out flyering if you had another guest, but you said, "Come on."
No, and as a matter of fact, thanks for reminding me. I've been playing cat and mouse with Cap Cahoots, Cap from Cahoots Magazine. We have a wonderful, loving relationship with them, cross promotional thing, and I've been wanting to. Have him on the show. We want to do a mutual cross interview thing, but things kept happening. Like, and last week I canceled. That felt horrible because I wanted to promote their groundhog thing, and then I couldn't go to that and everything because I injured myself. This is another thing. You can't tell that I'm injured right now, but I can't move my left arm any higher than that. And I fell twice roller skating, and everybody's already chewing me out for that. Yes, I fell on the same arm twice because that's what you're supposed to do. Everybody's, you're going to hurt yourself. You're going to hurt yourself when... I guess it's like the bike thing. You probably get people, you know, admonishing you for riding your bike everywhere. You're going to hurt yourself.
No, get hurt, not really. I think everyone has pretty much accepted this is what it is. So
okay,
yeah,
well,
like riding a bike is riding
a bike.
I don't
wear like the heavy gear.
I got taken out, right? The pads.
I like brakes. And, that's the one thing that's good.
Right.
About bike
I don't wear pads or anything when I skate either, and they wouldn't have helped in this particular occasion. The exact same thing would have happened. I fell while going backwards. Thank you, Summer. Not adult. I have friends named Summer at the roller rink, and one of them is a grown woman, and the other one is 12. So. The 12-year-old just took my legs right out from under me when I was skating backwards and just absolutely did a lateral and took my legs out. She was killing old men that day.
That's the one you were telling me about. Okay.
took me out. I fell backwards and I caught all my weight on my left arm. It just kind of jammed everything right up into my shoulder there.
No.
And that was on Sunday. And then on Wednesday, I'm skating around. I hit a piece of plastic. There was somebody's skate had come apart. This happens all the time. Somebody brings a cheap skate out onto the floor and then it starts coming apart. And so you got you've got debris. You've got whatever, something. I hit it and just stopped it. I wasn't even going that fast. That doesn't matter. You just hit it and I just stopped right where I was going and fell and caught my weight right on the same arm. And that was brutal. That was, and as soon as I hit it, I'm like, you're an idiot. Why are you even out here on the floor? So I was injured. That was my excuse for not being able to go to the Groundhog thing on Tuesday. I couldn't even move. It hurt so bad. I just felt like I had a whole body bruise over there. So I'm apologizing to Cap. Sorry, Cap, that I wasn't able to go to the Groundhog event early in the morning, and that I had to cancel the show last Friday. But hopefully we can do that. Cahoots Magazine. It's Hollywood's homegrown magazine. It's a wonderful magazine. We've got some samples there. Under the cooler is where I have some. As a matter of fact, if you want to grab one and do some show and tell, that stack right there under the, yeah, that's them. Anything down there at the bottom that says Cahoots, there you go. Show the audience. It's funny, it's irreverent, we have an ad in it, and Cap's going to be on it at some point. Put this over here. This is I can't lift my arm any harder. Take more candy if you want. So that's what originally I wanted to do, but I think he's mad at me right now. Speaking of the other guests, I wanted to have Cap on for an hour. But for the first hour, I wanted to rant and rave about a bunch of things. Finally got a new TV, Sunset. You need to come by and see it.
Ooh, what kind
finally
of TV?
This is the trivial stuff. Big and flat, you know? Like big my ex's flat. Ass.
Oh my God.
Anyway, I have this kind of, like, I don't officially declare it out loud, but with my electronics, my phone and my television, I say to myself, in the name of not being wasteful and extravagant and being one of those just consuming for the sake of consuming consumers, I say, I'm not going to replace this TV until it doesn't work anymore. Now, typically, when there's something that you like, it's going to break down, like, right, it's like 3 months, you buy it, 3 months later, boom, it's gone, and you got to replace it. That's how Murphy's Law is. But no, I bought this TV, and I should have gotten a flat screen right then and there, but I didn't, and it just didn't break, and it's a stupid big old box, you know.
The dinosaur
bone
TVs?
Crusher, the dinosaur,
yeah.
TV.
Those
and
always last.
Nothing wrong with it. I mean, it has the resolution of a light bright, you know, light bright, making things with light.
Yeah.
That's the revolution. It's the resolution is like 4x6. Not 400 by 600. It's just 4x6. It just has 4 pixels. I mean, that's, you can't tell who anybody is. Everybody looks like a snowman. Everybody looks like Frosty the Snowman. That's how bad the resolution on this TV is. But I finally couldn't stand it. The speakers didn't work. I had to hook external audio up to it. And I'm like, oh, happy day. The TV is now officially subpar. So I went the other extreme. I got a big old 48-inch for the bedroom. Built a smart TV. It's got built-in Wi-Fi, built-in Roku, because I didn't want to have to plug peripherals into it and everything. And it just sets itself up right there.
Isn't it the best?
And I'm like searching all these weird Roku channels. There's a Gaia channel. Gaia channel now,
like an Earth channel.
Yeah, and in addition to, you know, National Geographic has a channel and everything, and I'm still adding and taking things out, like, oh, this one has too many commercials and shit like that. Still exploring that, and I want to do a quick review of one of them. After Hours TV, a lot of potential. Of course, I popped it on because I thought that it was going to be nudity. Yeah, it's got some, but the thing that it has, that it has a lot of potential, and their explanation of themselves is curated content with fewer restrictions. And the fewer restrictions aren't just about nudity. It's kind of very similar to the concept here we have on SoFlo, where it's a freedom of speech kind of thing. So they've got a lot of, like, very indie movies, like very indie, and they've got a whole section of fan fiction, like like, and they have a big description of that, like, this is not monetized content. It is tribute and parody being used under the rightful use, something like that, the same excuse that like people like Weird Al use when they do song parodies or something like that. So they got this whole big disclaimer, but there's some shit on there, you know, like some fan-made Batgirl, some fan-made Terminator stuff, fan-made Alien stuff. And the thing about fan fiction is some of it's damn good. I mean, fans know what fans like, so they write for themselves, and their shit delivers. Like, you see the characters do the kind of things that you would want them to as a fan, and that's the whole good thing about
fans. That's nice.
So After Hours got potential, that stuff. The stuff with the models and everything, that's all like again, in a world where you can download any kind of porn you want really easily, having teaser videos, you know, videos with a striptease with a little bit of nudity, and then at the end for the full video, go to this website. And I'm like, yeah. Again,
I'm done.
Don't need that. some of the other channels on there, even though they have commercials, they've got, because I was talking about Something's Weird video. We played that Something's Weird open today.
Yeah.
Those really cheesy movies from the 60s and 70s, low budget, rubber suit monsters. Some of these other channels, movie channels that are, I call them Netflix-esque channels.
Yeah.
Like Popcorn and Crackle and things. They're like Netflix, but they show commercials. So they're free.
Oh, okay.
So you can tune in for free. A lot of cheese.
A lot of cheesiness. A
lot of really ripe cheese on there, which I just love. And while we're on the movie thing, because, of course, you know, you get the new big TV, so like, I'm going to watch some shit. I'm going to watch the fuck out of some TV now. And I got the TV, of course, just in time for me to be injured, and like, I really didn't need to be moving my arm. It was very tempting to go do something. It's like, stop. Every time you move, you're setting yourself back. Watched a very nice, pleasant to watch movie.
Ooh, what
doesn't
was it?
Happen. It's called, where is it? Time Out of Mind. And this is a very unlikely recommendation for me because it stars Richard Gere, who I don't like normally. Richard Gere from these all his movies. Man, I wish my nose would stop itching. No, I'm not doing any coke. Don't
trust you.
And I didn't smoke any more pot than usual today. You know, this is as druggy and hippie as of a shirt as I have. I need to do something about that. And it's a
beer. You get the new medical marijuana shirt on Saturday.
Beer shirt, yes.
Yeah, you got to plan that out. You got to go to that.
I got to go to this thing.
You got to go.
See, and again,
I'm thinking about going too.
My built-in babysitter just had a baby of her own, so I tend to not want to bother her.
Yeah.
These days, she's got a newborn, a two-week-old newborn. I tend to want to be helpful grandpa, not, hey, watch your sister so I can go to a concert.
It's a community event.
It's a community event.
It's a community event.
Yeah.
Nevertheless, I forgot where I was when I was tangenting.
The movie.
Oh, The Time Out of Mind. Thank you. Because, man, there's so much that I could have been talking about. You know, David Bowie, that's, I take my hat off, but my headphones are on. Because that was, I was a David Bowie fan since I was a little kid. You know you're a fan of somebody when you liked them as a little kid and you didn't know that's who that was. And then years later, or subsequently, as you get older and start learning the names of artists, and you hear a song by that artist and you realize that that's one of your favorite songs, you didn't know the name of the song, you didn't know who did it, it's just, remember being a little kid and really digging that song when it came on the radio, and that was David Bowie. I mean, the Beatles, my brothers and everybody told me from day one when a Beatles song came on, this is the Beatles, this is the Beatles,
you better
song.
Like
I always knew who the Beatles were, and I did. I liked the Beatles since day one, but I always, you know, anytime from the age of four on, when I heard a Beatles song, I knew that was the Beatles. Everybody around me was, you know, the DJ, and you put the sound together. Eventually, you got to know Paul's voice. But David Bowie, every time that there was a new album, it was so very different. And, you know, when I put it together that this was Bowie, and that's Bowie too, it's like, wow, this is really great. And then I got to see him in concert. Thank you, Fat Andy, for taking me to David Bowie concert. Watching TV one day, I hear a car come to a skid on my lawn. Somebody just pulled right up onto my lawn. and came skidding out my yard. And I thought, what the fun is that? And there's my friend Andy, who weighed, you know, like, I don't know, 500 pounds.
He's dead. Oh my God.
He's dead now. Guess why?
Because he was 500 pounds.
Yeah, anyway. He's like, George, get in the car. Get in the car. I got tickets for David Bowie.
Flapping
my arms, and I throw the shoes through the window, and we went. And it was when I saw him at the Miami Arena when it was really, you know, the little small venue, and it, you got to see. It was really good seats, and he was doing all his hits, and that was great. Meanwhile, back to movie Time Out of Mind. Richard Gere, very nice watch, and everybody that knows me, that's heard me do movie reviews, knows that I have a big issues with endings, movie endings. I really think that's the art of movie making is very similar to the art of joke telling, and that is, it's all about the punchline. I don't care how good the joke is, if there isn't a punchline or the punchline is shitty, you just wasted my time. That's how I feel about it. And that there is an art to storytelling, and the art is. And then it's just my opinion as a art viewer, all right? The art to storytelling is all about the ending. You really need to start there and then work towards that. Anybody can just make up a whole bunch of horse shit, a sequence of events, all right? And then just stop making up a sequence of events. You know, once upon a time, there was this dude, he rode a bike, he clipped the pole because his handlebars were too long, he fell, he broke his leg. You know, you can just keep doing that all day long. Just keep, but if it's pointless, meaning it's not going towards a point, what's the fucking point? So, I'm all obsessed with endings, and I'm all sucked into this story. I'm watching this movie, and it's a really pleasant watch, and I'm very sucked into his character. He did a good job. He's a homeless guy trying to get his shit together, and it goes into that. It goes into the homeless situation. He's in New York, so it follows him as he tries to get into a shelter, and there's a process, and even that, there's red tape. It's not just you just go to a shelter and they take care of you. There's this whole process and this whole system that he's got to try to work through, and you know, you really feel for this guy.
Does he get through the system?
And it gets to the point in the movie where I can hear the music and I can tell that they're wrapping it up and it's coming to an end. And I'm right there. I'm starting to wind up a brick to throw at my TV because it looked like they were just going to end this shit without ending it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They were going to do that. And I really hate this. I want to punch people in the mouth. I'm going to give two movie reviews before we get into, you know, the medicinal marijuana thing and Bernie. Because, hey, tell me you're not for Bernie.
Feel the burn.
All right, good, because yeah. I contributed to that guy. I didn't get my bumper sticker. I did something wrong. Anyway, so I can hear the music coming on, and I can feel it. I can feel it that the movie's coming to an end. And I'm like, they're not going to. They better fucking not end here now this way. And right before it ended, they pulled it out. They took that last loose string and tied that fucker down. And I'm like, awesome. I gave it a standing ovation. It's like, perfect, you guys. Oh, you guys, you had me. You had me. I was so convinced they were just going to pull the rug out. And they didn't. It was a wonderful, wonderful ending, wonderful closure. It left me, because, and again, George's movie reviews. Watch a movie, I want to feel good at the end of it. I want to feel like my time was well spent. I don't want to feel like I was jerked around. I don't want to feel like I was jerked around.
No, I feel.
I want to feel like that was a good investment of an hour and a half. I feel good right now. I can go do something. You know, like I had a good meal. I can go on to the next thing that I'm going to be doing today, riding my bike to the beach or something, and feel good. Not, oh man, an hour and a half, I'm never going to get back. I just blew it. An hour and a half. Which brings me to the next movie I want to review. And it's the absolute last time. I swear to all of everybody, the universe, that it is absolutely the last time that Quentin fucking Tarantino is going to take any more of my precious life's time.
No, you don't like
Quentin. Oh my God. Really? If I ever run into him with my car, I'm going to back it up. Back it up to make sure that I get him. I'm going to aim for his head. I'm going to back it up.
No Pulp Fiction, no.
No Pulp Fiction. See, I remember day one going all the way back, and I liked Quentin in the beginning. Mm-hmm. And little by little, I started to notice there were things that I like and things that I don't like. Things that I don't like, I call those things Quentinisms. All right. Quintinism number one, repeating the same shit over and over again.
Oh, right? Okay.
He really likes that, to repeat. And I like the, you're, that's an excuse. That's not storytelling. That's padding. That's an excuse for not storytelling. Quintinism number two, he really likes the N-word. He loves the N-word, man. He can't have that in a movie enough. And I like, dude, you got your N-word quota in the first 5 minutes of this movie. You should just stop right now. I'm starting to get offended on behalf of all the black people that I know. I'm getting offended.
Word.
You know, I don't. I said, you understand? You know, and I've heard his mealy-mouthed rationalization for it. Like, look, black people, Spike Lee, they're movie makers of color that don't use the word like you do. Buddy, you obviously like that word, man. You'd like to write that word. You like the way it looks on that script. You write the fuck out of that word in your scripts, and I'm tired of that. But the biggest, and by the way, because Pulp Fiction, like, I liked it. Like, the Quentinisms that I like is that he can be funny.
Yeah.
He can be funny. There are some funny things, and he can be surprising, but then he started borrowing from himself. Good Lord, I'm going to just cut my nose off today. He likes to borrow from himself. Like the scene in Pulp Fiction where he's in the pawn shop and he keeps upgrading his weapons. You know, yeah. He's going to leave and he keeps seeing, he's going to go help him and he gets the baseball bat and then he sees the chainsaw and then he sees, you know, that was funny. See, so Quentin can be funny. And it started out, Quentin movies, when he was making early on, he did a good job delivering what the audience likes because he was a movie buff. And so he started that, so the story goes. Making the kind of movies that he himself would like. Well, I cannot believe that he himself would like the kind of movies that he's made, like The Hateful Eight is the movie that I'm talking about right now.
Okay.
And the other one, the one that he made with the Nazis.
Oh, yeah, Incredible Bastards Bastards. Yeah,
Inglourious Bastards.
There you go.
Where the whole movie is just these people in a room talking. And then all of a sudden, there's some action. He did the same thing in when he did The Grindhouse, the double feature with Robert Rodriguez. I don't know if you saw those. The Robert Rodriguez movie, Planet Terror, was great. A wonderful, thunderful, raucous ride of fun. The movie that Quentin did, which was Death Proof with the cars, eventually, it was, here they are in a restaurant repeating the same Robert Frost poem over and over and over again. And then the last 10 minutes of the movie, there's a car chase. That was that movie. That's what he did there.
What and about this one, like Kill Bill? Like, did you? I like that.
Yeah, that
one.
Could have been one good movie.
Kill Bill was pretty cool.
Yeah that could have been one good movie. Like, yeah, they could have edited that together into one because he was doing that like the fat, long, drawn out conversations where you're saying the same thing over and over again. Michael Madsen, the guy with the droopy face, the tall guy with the droopy face. I really hate him. It's another thing. Quentin, I don't know. He must have naked pictures of Quentin Tarantino with a billy goat. I hate that guy. And Quentin puts him in all of his movies, and he's in The Hateful Eight. The Hateful Eight, I hated that. First of all, it took me three tries to get through it. I had three sessions with that movie because I kept tuning out, like not falling asleep, but my brain. You know, because it was just so the same thing over and over again. First of all, they're just locked. They're snowed in a cabin. The characters are snowed in this trading post during a blizzard. All right. So it's basically just this conversation and the events that unfold here in this cabin. The budget of this movie, I can only imagine. What, $5? I think if we all pooled the money that we have in our pockets right now, we could match the budget for that movie. It was just one room and, you know, whatever he paid the actors. That was the whole movie. But first of all, there are no likable characters in the movie. Like, you know, in a movie, in a story, you need to like the main character, the protagonist. You need to give a shit about what's happening to at least one of the characters, because otherwise, you know what I mean? Why am I watching this? You don't care. There's no emotional investment on your part. So three sessions, I'm watching and I'm just so, like, my brain, my eyes aren't falling asleep, my brain is falling asleep. You know how your ass feels when you sat on it too long and your ass goes numb? That's what my brain felt like. My brain was going numb. I'm like, ah, what the hell? And then I kept backing it up because I'm thinking the reason that my brain is hearing white noise when it sees this movie is because I'm missing something. I'm missing something in the dialogue. I'm missing some plot. So I would back it up, you know, back it way up to see what it was that I was missing. And I'm like, nope. I'm not missing anything. They're just repeating the same shit over and over and over again with Lincoln, the letter that Lincoln wrote him. Lincoln wrote him a letter, and he's reading the letter over and over again. He's reading this fucking letter. And all the while, and after, and again, I finally got all the way through the movie because I just had to know. I just had to know if indeed they were going to go from beginning and all the way through this 2 hours plus of ponderous repetition, just people walking in circles, just the dialogue walking in circle, and then eventually people getting their heads blown off and shit. And, you know, thought I'm gonna make it all the way to the end of this movie just to see if there's a punchline or something. Nope. This movie was clean. This movie was perfect, squeaky clean, totally devoid of any plot whatsoever, any purpose whatsoever, any likable character whatsoever. And I'm, after a while, you know, because I'm rewatching parts of it, I thought at this point I just need to find a character and pick one, you know, to like or root for or something. Just find somebody. Okay, that guy. Oh, there, he's dead. All right, let's just keep watching this thing. I felt like a hamster on a treadmill. Never again, Quentin. Never fucking again. Do yourself a favor. Don't watch that. Don't watch The Hateful Eight. Watch this pleasant. And I know I sound like an old person recommending this.
No, I do the same thing with like music nowadays.
Richard Gere,
like, don't.
Playing a homeless guy. And it's just, at the risk of sounding cliche, it was very heartwarming. It warmed my heart. And that's...
That says something.
Yeah. Well, that's... I mean, what do you want out of art? I mean, there's so many art, you know, there's music, there's film, there's painting, you know, poetry, spoken word. God bless the artists in the world, and I am a fan of art, but I will tell you straight up, what I want out of art is I want to feel good. I want the art to make me feel good. Life is full of all kinds of real life tragedy. And I don't need an artist to make me feel bad. Life does a fine job of that, right? There's a lot of bummer shit going on that if you allow yourself to think about it, the children that are starving, the children in Flint that have died and are brain damaged because of the water there, Syrian refugees, you know, the slave trade. Another good movie, watch a wonderful movie, Cartel Land, about the Mexican drug cartels and two vigilante groups, one on the American side of the border and another one on the Mexican side of the border, that are trying to fight back against, you know, the overwhelming force and money that are these drug cartels. There's so, you know, and the drug cartels, when they retaliate, they take out whole families to make a point. You know, including the little kids. So there's so much tragedy in the world. I don't need a quote-unquote artist to, I don't know, to make me feel bummed. I don't need that from an artist. I don't, and I know that there's skill involved in all of these arts, and someone can paint a picture that can invoke a horrific sentiment in the viewer, and their skill level can be incredible. You know, that could be an incredible artist there.
But there's a message that does come through. Sure. It, depending on how you present it, you know, the skill and the technical elements are certainly part of it. But to convey an image, even if it's dark, even if it's somewhat depressing, but to be able to sort of transcend certain essence of that situation, I think that does have meaning. It's not necessarily what you want for a cheer up,
yeah,
but I do think it has value.
Well, yes. I can certainly appreciate an artist using their art to express something that happened to them, to express the pain or
society. It's not necessarily a personal thing, but there's a lot of,
and I see that, you know, and I've seen, you know, the subversive art and a lot of the political art that, you know, that makes you think kind of art.
Mm-hmm.
And I like that, but But with movies, but with stories, it's just a peeve of mine. I'm investing this time, you know, in this story. And there are movies and fiction. They're fiction. Like, why would you write that? That fiction. There's fiction where they make you like a protagonist and then something terrible happens to that protagonist. And there's no bright side. There's no nothing. It's just, I feel like, the writer and the director, they set me up, you know? They set me up for a big fall. It's like, why did you do that? I gave you money for this feeling that I have right now. I bought a ticket and I'm walking out of the movie theater and I feel like they should hide the razor blades at my house.
But I mean, not every movie has a happy ending.
No, and it doesn't have to have a happy ending, but it can have a hope. It can have a message of hope. It can have... it can have a positive sentiment. No, not every movie has a happy ending. And by the way, there are lots of movies, you know, they make lots of movies that are true stories, and a true story, the end is whatever happened, mm-hmm. not necessarily a happy ending. The end is the ending. Like, for example, like 300 was cheesy and eye candy and everything, but that was based on a real event. You know, these Spartans, you know, that's a thing that happened in history. These Spartans did hold off the Persian army, and yeah, they died. But look what they accomplished. And, you know, it's an inspirational tale still to this day over that. But there's a movie called El Norte. The ex made me watch this movie because she really liked bummer movies. Makes perfect sense. And... what they do is they get you emotionally invested in this brother and sister that came to America from Guatemala to escape. There was some gang that was dominating the town, and they escaped so that they could have a life. And just bummer things happen, and you're watching this movie, and you're thinking, man, something good is going to happen, and then the sister dies, and it's like more bummer things, and you're thinking this movie is going to end with him finally. Making it, finally getting that good job, getting to that good place, and no, he gets fucked again, and the credits roll, and the credits roll with him regretting leaving Guatemala. Like, oh my god, why did you make me watch this movie? Like, I'm really sad right now. I'm like choked up. Why? What was that? That was not even a true story of anybody. That was total fiction. Why would anybody write that movie?
I just like comedies. Anything that makes me laugh.
Yeah. Okay.
Makes me laugh.
Comedies are good. I wish I had the only comedy that I saw lately that I really liked is Sarah Palin endorsing Donald Trump. That was
actually the Tina Fey version.
The Tina Fey version. Yeah. Listen, because I love Tina Fey and I love her portrayal of Sarah Palin, but she has got the easiest parody job on the planet. Oh, Tina Fey. Itself, all she's got to do is read the transcript. That's. I mean, you can't really add much. Word. She's a walking parody
like her,
of herself. She doesn't have to read much. And then the Trump thing.
Oh my god! Don't do it.
I'm just and you know, on the one hand, I want to laugh that you know, that Rafael Cruz beat him. By the way, he's a spick. Rafael Ted mm-hmm. Cruz, Canadian. That's not his real name, a Canadian spick. I totally wasn't born here. Beaner refugee. You know, he won. He won in the Iowa caucus over Donald Trump. And while
I actually think that's a good thing.
I do too. First of all, that made me laugh. I guffawed. I went, I guffawed a goofy laugh when I heard that. And then immediately I scared myself because, you know, he's like really evil. You know, whereas Donald is a big fat clown that no serious person is taking seriously. But Ted is a thoroughly evil, capable individual. You know, he was the Bush lawyer during the whole Bush election thing. Like, he's an effective tool of evil. He's the one that paralyzed the government. That was him. You know,
I just don't think he's going to win. I think.
Oh, I agree.
I think the whole clown car that they have for the Republican side right. really can't stand up in a real debate against either Hillary or Bernie.
You know, you're right. But think about this: the people that are that like those guys, they don't understand real debate language.
It really comes down to, are there more progressives or sociopaths?
Well,
and I think you put a sociopath on the other side, you will motivate enough of the progressives, especially if it is someone like Bernie going up there, that people will get out and vote. Because, you know, what we've seen in the primary is really just the appetizer of the full crazy buffet that we're going to get, starting with, you know, the ads really haven't started running.
No.
It's all
they haven't.
All talk show. And listen, it's all new type.
See, because here's the thing. To me, it's a no-brainer. I've been hating Donald Trump since before it was popular, because I'm personally people. I've been doing these shows for a long time, so they're archived. They're out there. From the day I heard of the existence of Donald Trump, I spat on the ground. This crass human being who represents everything that I hate about the world, the yachts with the gold fixtures and all this horrible shit. You know, I think back to the French Revolution, because, you know, I'm a time traveler. You know, I do that.
That's a good skill.
I think back, yeah, well, I asked God for an ability. Actually, I didn't actually ask. God granted me my wish without me asking, because he knew what my wish was. You know, that's how God operates, in case you didn't know. You don't have to go through a ritual. You don't have to do incantations. God already knows what your desire is, and if he feels that you're worthy, he'll grant your desire. That's how that works. So I wanted to time travel. Specifically, I wanted to be able to go back and witness big events, like events that I was curious to see how they actually went down. Like the very first time that our ancestors turned on a predator, you know, because once upon a time we were prey. Like the saber-toothed tigers ate us. But now they're extinct and we killed them all. So there had to be a turning point. I wanted to be able to go back and witness that first caveman that grabbed a stick and turned around and said, fuck you up, tiger. Somebody had to do it. Somebody had to be the first one. It was very inspiring, by the way. It wasn't just one. It was a collective. Okay. But that's the thing.
It was a bit of Vandal Savage.
That's a lesson.
Action.
Yeah, absolutely. So anyway, the French Revolution, okay, a lot of people may or may not, well, in America, most people don't know anything about it, but all the aristocrats got their heads cut off. You know, this is the cycle that happens, the French Revolution, the Russian Revolution, the Chinese Revolution. This perpetual cycle will always repeat itself, because there will come a time when the people, you know, they just won't take any more shit and fuck you, and they know exactly who's fucking them, because there they are riding by in a golden carriage while they're digging in the dirt. All those beautiful Fabergé eggs that tour the world, you know, we went to the show, mm-hmm. the Fabergé egg show. While they were making those beautiful Fabergé works of art, right on the other side of the palace wall, people were digging with their bare hands in the frozen tundra, trying to get grass roots to eat. They were eating the roots from the grass, from the sod in the ground. And on the other side of the wall, Fabergé eggs, you know. And so what happened? They all got killed. Russian royalty all got killed. They were lined up and shot, the lot of them, the family. And that's what the French did. They couldn't take it anymore, and they chopped off not all of the aristocrats' heads. Some of the aristocrats, not only did they not get their heads cut off, but they were hailed as heroes by the revolution and given positions of power within the new French system. Because they were the aristocrats that were always known to be advocates for the poor and were always very helpful to the poor and always implored their fellows to change the system. And the people, the revolutionaries, knew exactly who those people were. So the phrase noblesse oblige is a French term, which means the obligation of nobility. That's what noblesse oblige means. And for those of you who may be gone to Florida schools, that means we call that the Spider-Man principle in modern times. Remember, Spider-Man's uncle said, with great power comes great responsibility. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, Spider-Man pursued a selfish interest. His uncle got killed. And that's when his uncle's words sank in. I've got these powers. If I don't use these powers for good, I'm a dick. All mm-hmm. right. That's Spider-Man talk for noblesse oblige. If you are a nobleman and you don't use your position in life to better people that aren't as blessed as you, you're a dick, you're a douchebag. And then the French set out to demonstrate how they felt about nobility that pursued selfish interests rather than dedicating their lives to the betterment of the people. They cut their fucking heads off. And and the peasants that sided with them cut their heads off too. That's what happened during the French Revolution. While other nobility were hailed as heroes for always being there. Noblesse oblige. I really believe that if you are blessed like the Donald was, and instead of taking your money and doing something positive with it, you buy gold. It's within his rights. It's totally within. Yeah, it's within his rights. Dick, you're still a dick, all right? As opposed to people like Bernie, who've been fighting the fight since day one. He's been on the side of the people since day one. And I absolutely believe that you know, we're living in an oligarchy. I was aware of it and saying it before I heard Bernie say it. As a senator from Connecticut, he would just pop on every Vermont. Now and then. Oh, Vermont. Sorry. Thank you. I'm so glad. That's why Flash is here. Is correct. And that's why he explains that he's soft on the gun thing. But I don't disagree with him about that.
He actually still has a low marking, even with the NRA, sure. Even with his.
Nevertheless, I'm from Montana, and there are a lot of hippies with guns in Montana. And I always tell people, you know, who do you think they're going to come for? You know, look at these Oregon militant douchebags, the Oregon militia,
yeah.
these crackpots with their criminal records. The guy that got shot, Lavoie Finicum, in case you didn't know, he had 11 foster kids. That was his source of income.
Oh my God.
He had a ranch that didn't make any money. He only broke even on his ranch. His mainstay, his main source of income was 11 foster kids that the state paid him to take care of. They were taken away while he was doing the criminal activity, because guess what? You can't be a foster parent if you're openly engaged in criminal activity.
Yeah, no, that's not a good
and
idea.
And these hypocrites, they've got subsidies, they got handouts, they've got all these tax breaks from the government, but it's not good enough. So they go and occupy the nature reserve there, and nobody does anything. Nobody does anything. You know why? Because they were armed. You know, the American
sort of
Revolution.
That notion of if they leave them alone, they will sort of go away. Which did sort of happen versus go out there with extreme force and then it ends up turning into a bloodbath, you know, sort of Waco style. Like Waco. And then you just invigorate the whole right wing element. I think they were good in some respects about being cautious. It's not engaging on their level.
I agree.
But I do think that all those people should go to jail because
they should go to jail.
They did commit a criminal offense.
I don't. It took in the 70s. There was a group of African American protesters that were protesting. This national park was on land that was taken away from their grandparents, and they weren't properly compensated for it. It was in Georgia or something. Somewhere like that. I posted it on Facebook. Anyway, it took the feds 3 days to haul them off to jail. They came in and hauled them off at gunpoint for having a sit-in. They were camping. They were unarmed. They were having a sit-in. No, I agree. I don't think the government should have gone in there with guns blazing, but they should go to jail. But that's exactly right.
They had mail going to them. They were blocked off and sort of isolated, sure. You know, sort of like, okay, you want to camp here? You want to keep this? You're cut off. You know, cut off the power. No going back and forth. You know, no getting more supplies coming through. You know, if they were going to be real, they should have been real. But they really were very soft on them because they didn't want it to turn into a bloodbath. And I think, you know, there's a lot of criticism to go around on that side.
Well, I think they should. I agree. They shouldn't have gone in there, but they could have blocked them off. They could have just like not let them come and go freely. Well, what was that all about?
I think it was sort of ignore them so they don't get their any sort of bigger attention. But
you know what they're advocating, right? You know what they're fighting for.
Well, they wanted to go burn the forest so they could have more ranch. And you know that is a national park set up by a Republican, actually.
Yes, Teddy Roosevelt, and that's where the word conservative comes from. Is he wanted to conserve America's natural resources for future generations rather than just let them be slashed and strip mined and destroyed. That's a good thing. And these guys, it's not just the cattle grazing. They want all of those national parklands and all those federal lands opened to mining, strip mining, like they did this in in Appalachia and West Virginia. The mountaintop mining, the strip mining that they're doing, where they just shave the mountain one layer at a time to get to the minerals.
Yeah, and then the mountaintop just, removal. They mountaintop just they take off the whole mountain.
Yeah, and, that's crazy. And it's horrible. It destroys everything. The runoff, the silt chokes the creeks and rivers. All the fish die.
And a lot of chemicals in that too.
Yeah, yeah. It destroys the environment. Coal mining, oil drilling.
Fracking,
burn the forest so you can graze cattle on it. So nothing to enjoy. This is what these guys subsidized. Are fighting for. Yeah. So that made me a little bit crazy. But the whole thing with the guns and back to Bernie, and I've been telling this to my left leaning friends for a long time. If you were raised, your attitude, if you're raised in the city, is very different than if you were raised in a rural area. And the people that are raised in rural areas really don't feel the fear that the city folks do about the firearms. The people that are raised in the rural area, the firearms are everywhere. They're ubiquitous. It's a non-issue there. And they aren't raised, it's like this forbidden fruit or this big deal. Ooh, you know, everybody goes to hunter safety. It's like, even if you don't want to hunt, you have to go to hunter safety because there's guns everywhere, kid. So you need to know how to be.
They're not using M16s.
They're not. Well, no, they're not using M16s, and they're not crazy crackpots. But they do have handguns, and they do like to go out and shoot for fun. And me and my friends would go out and shoot for fun. And there's a whole issue here that I really try to bridge the gap, because on the one hand, absolutely America would be safer if there weren't all these guns, if the guns weren't as prolific as they are. Absolutely, America would be safer. But the genie is out of the bottle. And at this point, it's like it was with cigarettes. You know, the only thing that America has been, the only bad habit that America has been successful in reducing is cigarette smoking.
Yeah, that's
And that was accomplished through education, through ads, through showing people what the effects of cigarette smoking are. And, you know, the taxing, heavily taxes, it's very expensive to smoke. It's a very expensive habit. But cigarettes weren't made illegal. Look what happened when they made alcohol illegal. Did anybody stop drinking? No. Instead, what happened is we made gangsters very wealthy and powerful. Mm-hmm. Because whenever you make something illegal, there's going to be a segment of the population that sees no problem enriching themselves, providing something that the government is trying to stop you from having. Mm-hmm. And if you make guns illegal, you know that you're just going to make gun runners very wealthy, and you're going to create a black market gun industry. It happens all the time. And I really believe that the NRA wields undue power. They wield undue power, and the power that they wield doesn't come from the right. It comes from
the manufacturers.
It comes from their financing. But see, they use the right's fear that their guns are going to get taken away. They use the fear that is generated by the left, the fear that someone's going to come and take my gun, which is a big fat lie. It's a big fat lie that anyone's going to be going around confiscating guns, that there's going to be this door-to-door campaign confiscating guns. But politicians and the NRA profit from perpetuating that lie, that the people on the left are coming for your guns. The people on the left are coming for your guns. Every time we get a Democratic president, gun sales go up as everybody runs out to buy more guns and stock up on guns and ammo because they're coming for our guns. The right has done a masterful job of convincing their constituents that the people on the left are coming for their guns. And I think that they wield way too much power from that myth, that the people on the left need to stop fueling that myth. I think that there are bigger issues, more important issues, like healthcare, like the campaign finance reform, like the TPP, the wars, the fact that we're locked in perpetual warfare by the military-industrial complex. Imagine, if you will, fantasize with me, Flash, if you will, if you could take one of those issues that I just mentioned and zap it and deal with it. The war thing. If you could just end America's involvement in war, you know,
that ties into healthcare. The manufacturers as well. You know, because we have more gun manufacturers.
Yes, we do.
The military-industrial complex on that side as well, because it isn't about.
Right.
Well, otherwise, we'd be going to Rwanda. And
the M16s that you were talking about. Those are different. You know, those, that's a different market. The military market, and we're selling our guns to our own enemies. We sell guns to everybody. Our you know, we, the
and Pentagon, we have graveyards of tanks and airplanes that have never been used, that cost billions of dollars, and
the Pentagon's giving tanks to police departments and everything. But I just,
the FTAA showed that.
I just, this ties in with the Bernie thing, because I think that you will gain, or rather, you politically, you will lose fewer votes if you just leave the gun thing. Like, make a list of importance. Make a list of the things in America that are important.
Water.
Like medicinal marijuana, water, the EPA. Make a list of the things that are important. Healthcare, universal healthcare. When I make a list of the things that are important, the number of guns in our society is not in the top five of the things that I would change right away about America. The things that's taken the highest death toll right now, heart disease. So we need better medicine, and we need food. better education, mm-hmm. because the heart disease that is the number one killer in America is diet related. So we need better education to
better food
and better food.
Better everything.
So as a pragmatist, I say, if we're going to address our problems, let us say that problem number one is the one that is taking the highest death toll. We'll call that problem number one, the problem that is killing the most people. And then problem number two is the problem that is killing the second most people, etc., and work our way down. And if we can sacrifice one of our pet issues, issue number six or seven, in order to accomplish issue number one or two or three, I'd say that's a fair trade. That's a fair trade. And because I know these people, I lived among these people, I lived in Montana, and the reaction that they have when they hear the gun issue come up is it kind of trumps everything else. You can't really get to them. You can't have a conversation with them if they feel that you're one of the people that wants to take their gun away.
I think that with the gun issue, and again, it's sort of a subjective notion, but I think most people are not going to try and take your guns away. I think the idea...
I know that.
But there's a notion of background checks and also insurance. Like if you have...
80%.
If you have a car, you need insurance.
Sure.
If you have a gun, you should have insurance.
All the way.
80% of Americans agree with that.
Yeah. I think that's fairly rational. And if more people could just get behind that, and yes, sure. There's some crazy people that should not have guns, and some of them may live in Montana, you know, and they may fear that I'm one of those crazy people that they'll take my gun or right. any version of that. There are certain people that should not have guns.
Yes.
You look like half my Montana friends, and by the way, and by that I mean like I know people that look just like you right now, mm-hmm. and with a sidearm. And would go to a bar with a Colt 45.
And somehow I think alcohol and guns are not a very good combination.
Man, they're not. Neither are alcohol and cars, but nevertheless, man.
And if you are behind the wheel and you have alcohol, then you need to go away for a little bit.
It's true.
Or go into treatment.
It's not.
Just to have some sort of rationale. You know, the idea of having, you know, people going to sporting events with a gun to me is insane, God. Because no one's ever lost their temper at a sporting event.
Right?
No one's ever gotten enraged over some drunken stupidity, and nothing stupid's ever happened.
We call that a recipe for disaster.
Yeah, and it really just doesn't make sense that they're making this okay.
My point before, and I'd like to take a break today, and you know we're on this because of the Bernie thing, is that I really believe that politically the people on the left could break this stranglehold, because right now it's, you know, Republican both houses, you know, or has been. I call it just drop the gun issue temporarily. Just stop talking about the gun issue temporarily. Win the fight on these other fronts, address these other fronts, and then when you've got some political clout, some political momentum going, when you've got some of your people that have gotten into office and you're going to help them get into office, but just we're not feeling differently and we're not taking off of our agenda, we're just going to stop talking about it for a while, get some of our like-minded people into office and get some of these big issues done, and then we'll get to the gun thing. You demonstrate your credibility. Solving some of the other some of America's other problems will give you credibility with the American people, so that when you do bring up a good idea like background checks and things like that, then people won't be so quick to bristle, you know, because you've already accomplished some other really positive things for them. Yeah, that's my
suggestion. But I think what you mentioned there is that so many elected officials run essentially unopposed in the congressional districts.
Gerrymandering.
And the reality is, certainly in Florida, there are more Democrats than Republicans.
Yeah, and in the nation, there are more registered Democrats.
I think what the presidential election, if we have Cruz, Trump, Rubio, any of the other crazies, you know, that are there versus Hillary or Bernie, you know, that's going to galvanize people. Because right now, as the Republicans are sort of squabbling among themselves, they're in their own sort of bubble. And they're not really addressing an issue outside of their bubble.
There's wonderful fun infighting going on.
Yeah, and they're spending a lot of money just to try and get some sort of name recognition out there. You know, I saw some post about Jeb Bush spending so much money on votes.
Wow.
And he's sinking.
He's done. He's out.
I had a shirt that I made during the first Bush administration. Pot is an herb, Bush is a dope. And I use that for Bush Sr. And I use it for 8 years of George.
You're going to get that out again.
Well, I had it for Jeb and when he was for here. And I'm actually happy that I'm going to be able to not retire the shirt, but not have to make new ones for another campaign. Because I just want to get past a Bush dynasty.
We're done with you guys.
You know, I think that we can come up with other slogans of other Republican stupidity.
Yeah, I don't like dynasty thing. I think you know, the American Revolution, hereditary wealth, hereditary power. You know, fighting against
the
that.
Oligarchies. Yeah.
Corporate feudalism. That's the most recent Bernie post that I just put up there. I don't know if you saw it. It's got a picture of Bernie holding his glasses there, and he says, "Nice oligarchy you have there. Be ashamed if something were to happen to it." I really am offended by oligarchy. See, I put that as public enemy number one, the oligarchy system that we're currently under, because that keeps us from making any changes whatsoever. That makes whatever other issues we have, it's not even relevant, because as long as we're in this oligarchy, we'll never have our issues, any of our issues addressed.
Well, that ties in with the whole notion of a non-voter population, because people don't feel like it matters to vote, but we've seen time and time again that it does count. And when people do vote, you know, you may not win every time, but at least going out there and do it.
Florida during the hanging Chad debacle, you know, how close that was.
Yeah.
Look how important that is. And I'm very, you know, Bernie, speaking of, you know, things that warm my heart, seeing him on the scene, somebody said it, I wish I knew who said it, and all my life I've voted for the lesser of two evils. This is the first time that I actually get to vote for a good, someone who's actually good, an actual good person, someone who's been good.
That's where the primaries really come in. Like, and our primary in Florida is in March, and it's important to recognize that unless you're a registered Democrat and you register in time, you cannot vote in the primary. So for everyone that does support Bernie or anything within the Democrats, you have to be a registered Democrat.
Right.
And I'm happy to say we will have voter registration at the medical marijuana concert this Saturday.
Yes, go and vote.
What
please
do you need to bring?
Register.
Well, you just need to go there and just fill out the form. But there's a 30-day window between filling in the form and actually being registered within the party, and the concert falls within that window. So you sign up on Saturday, you'll be ready for, I think it's the second week of March.
Let's hit the concert real quick, and we go in the break, and then we'll come back and do some details. It's the 18th annual medical marijuana benefit concert at Gramps in Wynwood. By the way, that's my grandfather name. I chose Gramps. Everybody got to choose.
So you are Gramps?
Grandpardon. I mean, yeah, just 2 weeks
what
now.
What a Gramps?
Grandfather for the just 2 weeks ago it happened.
Congratulations.
Gramps. I get to be Gramps because I'm going to be the cool grandfather. And it's tomorrow, February 6th, from 4:20. Coincidence. Just absolutely no thought went into that.
Good planning, actually.
From 4:20 until 3 a.m., 18 or older with an ID. Admission is $15 at the door. You can go to ploppypalace.com and find out more. And we're going to talk more when we come back. You can buy tickets there and everything. More with Flash and Ploppy Palace and medical marijuana when we come back on SoFloRadio.com.
When you're ready to actually lose weight safely and steadily while being monitored by a physician, the Weight Loss Clinic of Dr. Kim Jacobson is there for you. The family medicine practice was established by her father in 1956 and continues as a medical practice that now specializes in weight reduction. Dr. Kim Jacobson joined the practice 20 years ago as both a family medicine practitioner and weight loss specialist. The Weight Loss Clinic utilizes a combination of appetite suppression medication and vitamins to produce great results, usually 3 to 4 pounds per week for most patients. Now you can change your lifestyle while still enjoying your own food, just less of it. They offer a choice of 2, 3, or 4 week plans. So whether you just need to lose a few pounds or a lot, the Weight Loss Clinic of Dr. Kim Jacobson can help you. They're located at 5454 Northeast 4th Avenue in Miami, just 2 blocks west of 54th Street and Biscayne Boulevard. Call them at 305-751-0091. They'll be happy to answer any and all of your questions. That's 305-751-0091. Get started on a beautiful new body today with Dr. Kim Jacobson and the Weight Loss Clinic.
Tune in to Z Nation Radio for the latest in good news about good people doing freaking great things in the world.
Every week, Zayna De Gaia and Sunset Martinez chatted up with some very interesting folks about their businesses.
It's about love,
consciousness,
and making a difference. Every Thursday from 12 to 1 p.m. at SoFloRadio.com.
Put a team of professional consultants behind your home or business computer with Key Information Solutions, providing solutions to your internet and computing needs while keeping you on the cutting edge of technology. Preventative maintenance and networking support, hardware and custom-built computers. Let Key Information Solutions be your personal tech staff for your home or office with affordable hourly, monthly, or annual rates to fit anyone's budget. Call Key Information Solutions now, 954-973-3374. That's 954-973-3374. Or visit keyinformation.com.
SoFloRadio.com, your headquarters for weed and prostitution.
Singing in a song, you can smoke it in a bomb, smoking pot.
Pot, pot, pot.
Well, it's the latest sensation that's sweeping the nation, smoking pot.
Pot, pot, pot.
Let's go smoke some pot. Let's go smoke some pot. Let's go smoke some pot. Let's go smoke some pot. Come on, let's go smoke some pot.
Well, there was Edie Brickell and the new Bohemian smoking pot.
Pot, 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 pot.
Well, there's the Black Crows and driving and crying smoking pot.
Pot, 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 pot.
There's the spin doctors and blues travelers smoking pot.
Pot, pot, pot.
Let's go.
Let's go smoke some pot. 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 Come on. Let's go smoke some pot.
Let's go.
I smoked too much pot.
Pot, pot.
I went to Lollapalooza and everybody out there was smoking pot.
Pot, pot.
I saw Blind Melon and then Red Hot Chili Peppers and Pearl Jam and Widespread Panic.
Let's go smoke some pot. Let's go smoke some pot. Let's go smoke some pot. Let's go smoke some pot.
Come on. Let's go smoke some pot.
Let's go.
Thank you. 223, SoFloRadio.com, The George Rodriguez Show. Flash is here. That's he's got one name. It's a one-name band, like Cher, like Sunset. And I'm George Rodriguez with the most boring name. Boring in two languages. I don't know what we're going to do. If I should just like subtly fade George Rodriguez out and then just replace him with the Ivan Bad Show. Or
the Ivan, you know, Bad Show is fun.
Ivan Bad Show is fun. As a matter of fact, we've also got the Ivan Bad Show, just like the George Rodriguez Show, is the flagship show of SoFloRadio.com, because it kind of all started with that. The Ivan Bad Show is going to be the flagship show of fuckyouradio.com, which we have. We have fuckyouradio.com and furadio.com.
What?
Because, you know about radio? Fuck you, radio. Radio, because radio, like, and I know you've been making the tour, like, NPR gives you some attention.
Sometimes.
Sometimes. Yeah. But that's it, right? I'm done.
Yeah.
I mean, because radio doesn't pay any attention to anything going on in this town. I do want to
There's a few good stations.
There's some. Well,
like Shake 108 helped us out last year.
Who? Where are they?
They're Miami based.
Oh, is it like?
And actually, WVUM
is that a low power? Love VUM. Got through high school because of that.
They were. I was on there twice this week. I was on the jam show called The Swirl on Sunday. And then I was on the Get Smart show, which is our science show on Tuesday, which was actually really interesting because I was there with.
Are they a low power FM? What, I've never heard of them.
What, Shaker?
Yeah, Shake One.
Yeah, they're newish and they're still low power, but they're pretty cool.
They're not those guys on Key Biscayne, are they?
I don't think so.
I don't know
so.
What their tower is. I shout out to them. Yeah, I don't know what their station is.
Shake 108 plays some pretty good music. I don't drive, so I don't listen to radio in a car very often. But when I do try and listen to them because they are pretty cool. It's just sometimes when you're driving, you run out of reception.
Yeah, well, that's my problem with VUM. I'm assuming they stream on the internet these days.
Yeah, actually, WVUM does. We did stream the show with Get Smart, and I had... Dr. Linda Kaplan on for that one, and we were really getting into the deeper science of medical marijuana, which was really cool.
What station are you on in this picture over here on your Ploppy Palace site?
That's on only in Miami, and that's 880 AM WBIZ.
Oh, WBIZ, yeah, the brokered station. Yeah, that's one of the stations I am. Was going to be on, but they wanted money. And it's like, if I'm going to pay to be on the air, I'm going to have my own platform where I can open it up to really cool shows like Z Nation live every Thursday, noon to 1 o'clock with super producer Emily Sunset Martinez right over here. And they have a big fundraising party coming up. So this is your 18th annual. And we were this close. I mean, you were the first person that I thought of when I was the last time that it was on the ballot when I'm watching the votes come in, and I saw that we weren't going to do it. I immediately thought of Flash, and I don't understand how that happened. Because have you gone north to the south? Have you noticed that, like, once you get past the Palm Beach line, it's crackers and banjos and alligators and inbred walleyed mugwumps, and with all due respect to the people north of Lake Okeechobee, but it's not very sophisticated up there.
Well, the campaign against medical marijuana was very well funded, and
by whom?
Because Sheldon Adelson is one of the people there.
What's with you, Sheldon? We've got the alcohol companies, the for-profit prison, which is. They're a blight. Another reason that I like Bernie so much is he keeps railing about that. That bothers me philosophically. If you have, like, war and prisons and illness, if you make something profitable, if a business profits from a circumstance, it will invest in perpetuating that circumstance. Mm-hmm. It will invest in increasing the circumstance of that circumstance. That's what businesses do. How can you not know that? How can you allow that to exist? For-profit prisons who lobby extensively for stricter laws and this.
Well, it ties into the whole privatization element as well. So they call it as a notion of, cost reduction, but in the end, it really just turns into more money for private interest. And that doesn't really help solve problems. And it does hurt people all around, where prisoners are being mistreated.
Sure.
They can't even keep drugs out of prisons.
I know.
So there's a reality.
That's the funny part. You go to prison, when you get busted with drugs, they send you to prison where you won't get any anymore.
But you're still able to get drugs, and it because there's corruption on all different levels. And I think if we address these things, like one of the problems that I'm seeing with marijuana law reform that has been enacted, it doesn't deal with the fact that there are still political prisoners in jail for marijuana, nonviolent marijuana offenses.
That's crazy.
And, you know, if you're smoking a plant, carrying a plant, growing a plant, you should be let alone to begin with. But if a place is legal that you're in and they change the law, there should be some sort of movement to get the people who are in jail out of jail because they are political prisoners.
Sure. But no, you have a company that makes money per prisoner. They're going to make sure that those prisons are full. And it wasn't in Florida. I forget what state. They signed into some weird agreement. It might have been Louisiana or something. But they did these are the same kind of things that happened with the Trans-Pacific Partnership or something. They entered into a contract with a for-profit prison that guaranteed X number of dollars per year based on this many prisoner, based on their statistic. Mm-hmm. Well, crime was low. So the conviction rate was low. The prison sued the state for the deficit. You understand?
Really?
And won because, well, we had a contract. You promised us a minimum of this many prisoners.
That's
crazy. And you're not convicting that many because crime was down. So there now you have a state that has to pay a penalty for doing something right, for being successful and reducing the amount of crime. And this is madness. It should be illegal. For-profit prison, for-profit war, and for-profit medicine. Because that's a problem we have. We're not working on cures. We're working on treatment. We're not working on prevention. We're working on how to treat the symptom by selling you a pill because that's where the money is. And it boggles my mind. That's what all of Bernie's things. And he's for legalization of marijuana.
Yeah. He's talked about sentencing changes. He's talked about just
everything.
Stopping the madness.
Finance reform.
Yeah.
He uses the word oligarchy, which I love.
He's a very authentic candidate, and he has a track record that does match it. And what he's doing with his speeches and how he's motivating people, inspiring people to vote, I think is great because compared to, say, Trump, who has really mass marketed the airwaves with all this outrageous stuff and all the commentary, Bernie has really been a grassroots, non-media phenomena. And I think the way that he's able to really approach
the media
on a whole bunch of ways, my Facebook feed is just chock full of Bernie. And that's because I'm not in like a million Bernie groups, but my friends are getting excited about it and posting different things. And it's great to see that type of support. And just looking statistically, Bernie's doing better attendance-wise than Obama did, doing better with donors than Obama did at the same time during his first campaign. And he's getting the crowds. And the fact that he essentially had a statistical tie with Hillary for Iowa is remarkable.
It is remarkable, and I think they there was some funny business going on there, but I don't want to split hairs with what was going on there. I posted one story about it.
The coin tossing.
Not the coin toss, because he won some coin tosses too. But it was some deliberate. There were Clinton campaign people being put in counting positions, and there were discrepancies in the counting. And the one the head of it all has a pro Clinton like license plate. His license plate is HRC 016 or something, and he's the one that is sitting on the actual vote tallies. They could release the vote tallies, but not. I think this is not, this particular caucus is not the final word. Obviously the election is going to be, and I think that the media has been in denial of Bernie's campaign, and because the media is all establishment. I posted a thing by Cenk Uygur, the Young Turks guy. Mm-hmm. Cenk Uygur, was explaining the whole the Washington Post editorial where they panned him. And there's no liberal media. There's no left of center media, unless you're talking about this, small mom and pop operations. Nicole Sandler here in the morning and on radio or not. There's no liberal media. All of these companies, whether it's TV, newspapers, these are all owned by rich people, and that's the establishment. And they don't want things to change, because the change that we're talking about is rich people paying more than they are right now. That's what Bernie is talking about, and rightly so. So. All of it, all of the things that he's talking about, the you know, the marijuana legalization, campaign finance reform. He's against the wars. He was against the TPP, which
he's against fracking too.
He's against fracking, mm-hmm. which they now that you're following what's going on in Florida in the House. Yeah. They just advanced that bill.
Well, fortunately, there's a bill by Senator Dwight Bullard. Also, shout out, happy birthday. It was his birthday yesterday. If you don't know Senator Dwight Bullard here from Florida, you should check him out. He is a really strong progressive Democrat who's done a lot of good work. He also supports industrial hemp and has a bill for full legalization.
Excellent.
So the South Florida representing, and what we were talking about before in terms of elections, there's sort of this sort of open gate for crazies. The Tea Party's really opened that one. And the Democrats have not really stepped up as far as getting more candidates out there. But there are some. Tim Canova, he's running for Debbie Wasserman Schultz's seat. He's
good. You're done, Debbie.
So he's going to be speaking at the concert. Dr. Alina Valdez, she's going to be – she's running right now for Mario Dio's Ballard seat. Stephen Mishat, he's running for – Marco Rubio's seat as a senator. So there are candidates that are coming out and fighting the establishment. And ideally, if the progressive movement can embrace the local elections as well as the national election, we have a better chance of, you know, sweeping out a lot of the stupid Republican policies and creating more of a center right now, because the center has moved so far to the right that the left has been left out, and we haven't had a real progressive candidate on Bernie's level for president.
Ever.
Yeah, ever.
Ever.
What, and I mean, I think this is an important step forward.
Seriously, and I thought about this, and this is a George original. The last time that we had a progressive, it was a Republican.
You know, FDR.
Yeah. Seriously, what president since then has been more progressive than him, or candidate even has been more progressive than him? That's how long ago.
There have been other candidates, because there are Green Party people and this thing.
Okay,
like
yeah,
and Bernie does embrace the Green Party platform in a lot of ways. So
he does.
I think that's a good step forward. And if the Green Party could get more momentum locally, nationally, mm-hmm. and actually get more people registering as green, right. and then voting, getting green candidates, that would help push these principles forward. But Bernie's doing it on a national level, and he still has not become a Democrat. He's an independent,
right.
working within the Democratic primary. So I think that's a bit of a revolution in itself, because he has not been completely shut out, but he has been marginalized.
I believe that the fact that he's an independent is part of his appeal with a lot of people. I think a lot of people, and I'm one of them, are very disgusted with the Democratic Party. I call them the D is for decoy, the Republican light. They're bought off, but to a lesser extent than the Republicans are. I mean, and there have been, you know, because like Al Gore, I really believe that he, you know, his heart is in the right place. But the Clintons are very moderate. Even Bill Clinton, who I liked, did a lot of right wing things when he was in office, you know, for business and things like that. And Hillary is totally Goldman Sachs. I'm sorry, Hillary. I mean, sure, I'm going to vote for her instead of Ted Satan Cruz. You know, I'll vote for her over whoever the Republicans are putting forth, but I'll be very sad. I'll be very sad if I can't vote for Bernie for president, especially after donating to his campaign there.
I think Bernie has a real chance of doing things, and I think that's a really inspiring position, because there are certain people that will not vote for Hillary because they don't want Hillary, and maybe they won't vote at all, or maybe they will vote like Jill Stein or Gary Johnson or somebody like that, because they're putting their principles forward. And I do recognize that, but I do feel like unless we do things on a local grassroots level, you know, particularly with, let's say, like the Green Party, I would love to see a Green Party real governor in Florida, or a real, you know, state senator or something on that level, because jumping straight to president when you don't have mm-hmm. a caucus to work with, where you don't have a real, not even a majority, just even a significant amount of electoral support as Green Party principal, you're not going to go forward. And I think if we had, you know, some senators, you know, so you don't have to go as big within the Green Party, I think that would help change the schism.
I think this is a step in that direction. Bernie keeps talking about a revolution. He's very quick to say that this isn't about me, that this is about a movement. And he's not going to be, you know, he reminds people all the time, he's not going to be able to do it alone as president. If both houses are Republican, it's going to be, they're going to do to him what they did with Obama. And that's just,
I would say probably worse.
Scuttle everything. Sure.
But I think the point is we have a potential to elect other people within that same wave. And if we create a voter block of candidates that can counteract the gridlock that we have as within the Republican establishment, we can see some changes. Mm-hmm. You know, and I think that's part of it. You can't elect one person. That was the problem with what happened with Obama. He pretty much said, okay, we're good, thank you.
Yeah.
And no. 2010, we got Rick Scott, we got the whole Tea Party backlash because the progressive electoral machine on the Democratic side stopped. And there was no other liberal, you know, mechanism to be able to keep the movement forward.
You know, Rick Scott isn't a human from Earth, right? He's an alien android.
You're giving alien androids a bad name.
Well, I mean, they're alien androids that are good, but he's from the planet douchebag, where you know everybody's a butt plug. That's why his head looks like that. It's like an alien android butt plug. So if you got the 18. You've been doing this 18 years. And man, you're going to be so happy when it finally gets through. It's going to be on the ballot again.
It is on the ballot. It is actually Amendment 2 again, which is very good for those people who had stickers and signs.
Where
and all stuff
you don't have to buy new ones.
What amendment is it? Oh,
well, they said it could have been Amendment 1 because they were really in motion. But
my coughing is strictly coincidental. I was sick last week.
The solar there was two solar campaigns that were in. That were happening. One was Floridians for Solar Choice. That did not get pushed through. But there's another solar campaign that's been sponsored by FPNL and the other energy companies. And they're doing a smokescreen situation there. So I would be very wary about that.
I really like your logo this year. It's subtle. It's it's very. I can see a lot of veiled references to marijuana there. It's good. That would make a nice T-shirt, a nice tattoo. You'll be selling these T-shirts.
Actually, we have another. We have something based on that because to do full color printing on that design is too expensive.
I'll bet.
But we have another design that has been created by Alonso. He's going to be doing some spoken word. This was an original painting done by an artist that Modern Galaxy TV help set up.
So let's go through that since you mentioned the spoken word stuff. You're going to have all kinds of spoken word dancers, live painters, performers, you know, music,
yes,
and more. I don't know, more bounce house. You're going to have a bounce house?
No,
bounce house. Oh, I wish.
It's 18 and over, but you know, some people like to bounce.
And I'm all for the bounce house thought. It's just help me. There's a little bit of space issue.
Help me pronounce all these wonderful names over here. We have Otto von Schirach.
Chirac.
I don't know.
Telekinetic Walrus.
Oh, I know Telekinetic. Yeah.
Do you? Johnny Dredd. Nog Champions, who were not in this studio, but in the old original location. Know them well, really nice guys. Sun Ghosts, yep. The Oski Foundation. Oski, we love DJ Oski here on the show. He's been on my show. He's been the original studio. He's been in here on Jack's show on This Is the Spot. Coming up this evening at 8:00. By the way, This Is the Spot with one Jack Frost. Apache Dragon, The Galactic Effect, Kuyaki. All right, excellent. Purple? Question mark.
Yep.
Purple. Aura the Band. Is it Purple Aura the Band, or is it just that two names?
Aura the Band is one.
Is one name Purple. Purple yeah. Question mark is another one. Okay, good.
UOM.
UOM. I don't know these people.
Unheard of music.
Oh, excellent. Fresh Air. Bobby Ingram. Rhythm Flow. I can handle these. Mr. Grim Reaper.
Yep.
Orion. Falsetta. Yes. I've heard of them.
Yes.
Them. Him.
Good band.
Him.
My first time working with them, but I like them.
Excellent. Rhythm.
Rhythm, yeah.
Ellen Buskell, Bustel. It's, oh, wait, I'm reading how it's spelled here. Buxtel.
Yes.
How's that? Is
yes.
it? Okay. Buxtel. Oren Bolton.
Yes.
Scars.
Yeah.
Aaron Libos Realty.
Reality.
Aaron Libos Reality.
Yes.
And he's they got a studio there. Right down the hall over here. Aaron Libos
Very
Realty
good over there.
Here. Emily Sheila. Alex DeLeo? DeLeo or DeLeo?
DeLeo.
Fudakochi.
Actually, he's not playing. He had a personal issue. He had this.
All right. Out. Well,
but instead, we have Cleveland Jones and we have Gypsy Cat that aren't on the flyer.
All right. Michelangelo.
Yep.
DJ Mello D.
Yep.
And more. We got speakers.
And more, yep. more.
And we got Joe Rock on there and Young Rails as well.
Excellent. The speakers, you have LV Musica.
Yes. She is a legal federal medical marijuana patient. She gets roll joints given to her by the federal government.
What?
She used to live in Hollywood.
Excellent.
And then she got busted. And she set, with the help of Normal, and Norm Kent is her lawyer, helped set up a medical necessity defense as a legal precedent here in the state of Florida. And then they went forward with the federal program and got her into that where she gets marijuana given to her, grown through the University of Mississippi. And she is one of like four patients in this program nationwide. This program's been going on for about 35 sure. years or so now. And there were more people in the program, but they were sick. Many of them had AIDS. And unfortunately, they have died. One of the other patients is Irving Rosenfeld. He was the first one in this program. He's still
been on my
here.
Show, yeah. the original location. I have his book in my bathroom, as a matter of fact. Yes.
He's not able to speak this year. He's been part of the show for many, many years.
Right.
And you know, what they've really been able to do is show that there's science behind medical marijuana, because they both get, you know, regular checkups.
Absolutely.
And they show that it's helping. And that's an important part of why medical marijuana is an important first step, because it brings the science to the forefront.
Sure. Anything, because mm-hmm. I'm reading, and again, if it's on Facebook, it must be true, the oil that seems to be curing so many people of their cancer. I mean, obviously, you're hearing this, is cure the appropriate word? These are the claims that I'm reading. At least reversed it or sends it into remission.
I've talked with a number of doctors on it, but again, the science is still being developed, because until you can have real studies, it's more, I wouldn't call it anecdotal, but it is a smaller sampling.
Mm-hmm.
One of the doctors that will be at this show, Dr. Nancy Powers, she's a holistic physician. She's used it for treating skin cancer and curing it, where she treats it, and then they go to a dermatologist and they say, yep, no longer there.
Do you put the oil on the cancer, or
yes.
you really, and yeah, or you ingest
for skin cancer? And then there's lots of topical elements that you can use, so it's not just only smoking or eating. They said there's ways you can use it as tinctures and balms and things like that, where you can get the different cannabinoids, you know, where they need to be. As I said, there's receptors in our body. We have an endocannabinoid system in our body designed for receptors of cannabis. Mm-hmm. That's
Crazy.
One of the reasons why when you take it, it lasts in our system for so long. You're not high for 21 days
right.
after smoking a joint. But because
not
of the
anymore,
way...
Not
anymore,
no.
No.
I don't know if I want to be high for 21 days. That's just too much.
No, but but it's in your system. So and it bonds with your fat cells, and it's part of our neurological makeup.
Sure.
You know, and that's an end part of the science that most people think, hey, I'm going to get high, smoke a joint. But there's a whole system within our body that reacts to it. And some people would say that, you know, there's a difference between medical and recreational. And I would say, as far as, you know, there's serious medical issues that need to be dealt with, that, you know, marijuana is definitely a treatment. And then there's some people that use it just to relax, and stress is a big killer as well.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I would say, you know, recreational, unless it's being abused to the point of not being functional, practical, or, you know, within your own sense mm-hmm. of being.
But that goes with everything, and including anger. You know, you shouldn't be driving your car under the influence of anger.
Yeah.
All of these things are not good ideas.
You know, but I think there's a sense of balance that we can create that, you know, if you possess a flower, you know, you are not a criminal. You know, there's a reality to what we're doing. You know, we're creating this punitive society that is really damaging the fabric of our culture. You know, when people can't trust the police, when people can't trust doctors because they're worried about punitive damages, we're degrading the essence of what it means to live in a free society. And I think we have to, you know, recognize this, that it's not just a cut and dry thing. And one of the reasons why I really support medical marijuana is because we can solve this problem. We can solve marijuana criminalization by making it legal, by normalizing it, by regulating it. And then we can move on to other issues that have much deeper problems. We have to take care of the Everglades. We have to take care of the water. We have to take care of, you know, global warming. And you can't do that with a signature, you know, but you can solve making a whole class of people, you know, millions of people from being a fringe underground to being, you know, within the greater part of our society and taking them away from a criminal element. And I think we have to recognize what we're really doing here.
Amen. And you got people that are running for office, I'm noticing here. Stephen Machat, is that how you say his name?
Yes.
Running for U.S. Senate, which is great. Dr. Jeffrey Camlett.
Yeah, he's an addiction specialist.
Okay, great. Rick Margolis.
He's a senior,
senior circuit court judge.
Yep.
It's court judge. He's going to say he digs it. Digs medical marijuana. Well, I mean, there are a lot of people, including law enforcement people that are in the system that would rather be concentrating on something else with their time.
Yeah, and there's an organization called Law Enforcement Against Prohibition. We're going to have one of the speakers there as well, because there are, you know, police, prosecutors, judges who have said this is a waste of our time and it's a waste of our resources.
I'm seeing, like, it's clearly like people are being so loud with like smoking weed, and I've seen cops, like, they know if they went in that corner.
I have a very loud bong.
Yeah. They know if they go in that corner, they're going to catch people. They're like, listen, we have bigger problems. I'm not going to go stop these people from smoking some herb.
It's been a long time. I go to concerts and everything. It's been a long time, and there's always cops running around. It's been a very long time since I've seen anybody take issue with anybody about that. It's almost like it needs to be formalized at this point nationwide. It's become such a non-issue. I don't know anybody that winces or bristles when, you know, think about it. The people that were smoking in the 60s, these are all retirees now. And
that's one of the ways that we're reaching out to those people that weren't necessarily hippies, but there's an organization called the Silver Tour, which is doing senior education. Because there's that, you know, gap between the current marijuana culture and the older hippies or post hippies, you know, and to be able to say, you know, older. Maybe you're using it for arthritis or glaucoma.
Not yet, but give me a minute.
Yeah,
because I'm a grandfather now.
I understand. But, you know, getting this.
Maybe I'll never get arthritis.
Well, if you keep...
I would have had arthritis and glaucoma, but I smoke a shit ton of weed.
It works that way, you know. It's preventative medicine.
It is. It prevents me from going postal sometimes. Yeah.
Again,
you know,
stress is a big issue.
Stress, in this town, we know that stress will kill you. Stress ages you. Stress gives you wrinkles. Stress will lead to a stroke or a heart attack. But people that I like, we mentioned the Montana people earlier, I explained to Montana, I have to explain to them the atmosphere here, because the atmosphere there in that little town in the middle of the woods is so very chill and so very calm, and everyone is so very polite. You don't have this asshole factor. It's maybe 10% asshole versus 90% asshole. Nobody's raging all the time when they're out on the road. Just imagine if people had the ability to take an edge off, to take that edge off, how much nicer they would be at the supermarket, how much nicer they would be just in general to their coworkers. it is so therapeutic, and I'm just talking about the mental health thing, and that leads to everything. There's a chain reaction of grief and hostility in this town, and I really think that most people could be served with a medicine that would take the edge off.
If everybody just knew how to take a breath,
yes,
and have a little bit of
that
herb.
Because you know she produces a yoga show too.
You know, everything will be a lot. Just chill.
Yoga's good too.
Yeah, yoga can get you high too if you didn't know that.
It can deal with stress.
If you forgot your joint one day, just take a couple deep
breaths. Yoga's good for joints.
Yeah.
It's a great way to work those joints.
You know, like, hey, you know, like we're getting too up there. Let's like take a breath and, you know, come back down.
At the roller rink.
Well, I think driving does a lot of that too. Like, personally, because I don't drive, I feel like I reduce certain stress. Yeah. I probably have come close to getting squashed more times than I realize, but I feel better riding my bike than driving a car.
Do you pretend when I'm on my bike, I pretend that I'm in a Road Warrior movie and all the cars are trying to kill me. That's how I approach the street. I like, if I give this motorist an opportunity to kill me, they'll take me out. This is death race and they're going for points.
Oh,
I don't
God.
Really go into that realm.
I do. That's how I keep myself safe.
I just am aware. I don't listen to headphones when I'm riding.
So okay.
Okay. To me is one of my things. Like, I'm just tuning into the road.
Do you have rear view mirrors?
No.
Yeah. Okay. I have rear view mirror glasses.
No, that would be
I look like a whatever. I look like a 70s, like a Kraftwerk or, you know, electro pop 70s person with my sci-fi glasses that I got at the Museum of Science. So, other speakers before we get done here, Students for a Sensible
Drug Policy.
United for Care, who are they about?
United for Care is actually the organization that sponsored the medical marijuana petition, and they've been very instrumental as far as networking and organizing to be able to get the signatures that we needed to be able to get this on the ballot, working with funding to be able to make sure that it happened, and just pushing it. You know, without United for Care, realistically, this wouldn't be what it is.
Excellent. I see you got Normal in Florida there, Norm Kent, my good friend Norm Kent.
Actually, Norm is going to be out of town this year, which is sad. But Normal of Florida will be representing. You know, and actually, Miami Normal is now starting.
Norm does a lot of good things sometimes.
Yes. Sometimes. Norm's been very helpful.
And other times.
He helped me sue the city of Miami Beach.
You go, Norm.
Yeah.
Excellent. What did you sue them for?
I got arrested while petitioning a few years ago.
That's right, you told that story.
What?
So,
yeah, and that's why he's got his shirt.
We sued the city and got some money.
Excellent.
It wasn't enough to sponsor the concert, but it was enough to pay my rent. So.
Very good. I notice as far as sponsors go, you've got Resurrection Drums there. My good friend Jeff Lee, I was just at his store yesterday. Have you been in that store?
I haven't been, but I've seen them in the art walks.
It's drum porn. Let me know. I've been talking to him, Jeff, doing a show, having a music show about the local music scene.
Cool.
Here. And I hope he does.
Today.
Speaking of music shows, before we leave, I want to shout out to Tony C, SoFlo Groove-a-thon from 2 to 4 every Monday here on SoFloRadio.com. He plays a lot of crazy groovy music and an eclectic collection of music that's all over the place from 2 to 4 here on Monday. Don't forget Silverman on Sports also on Monday. Nicole Sandler every morning from 10 until 12 with our good left of center political talk. Go Bernie Sanders. And don't forget, this is The Spot with one Jack Frost tonight. At 8 o'clock. Flash, thank you so much for coming into the show again as usual.
Thank you.
I'll
so
do what I can to
sharing.
Get there. I so very much want to go there. Gramps is at 176 Northwest 24th Avenue in Miami.
Street.
Street? 178 Northwest 24th Street in Miami, 33127. Remember, it's tomorrow from 4:20 until 3 a.m. And just go to ploppypalace.com. Ploppy Palace, it's spelled just like it sounds.
Yeah, P-L-O-P-P-Y.
Ploppypalace.com. Thank you, Flash. Thank you, Sunset.
Thank you.
Thank you, George.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Broadcasting from the heart of downtown Hollywood, this is SoFloRadio.com.